reading this lecture at the music gallery. It's called Plunderphonics or Audio Piracy as Compositional Prerogative. It's an essay. Supposedly that's why we're here today, is because of that. At the time, I'd done a whole pile of examples of these things, but I hadn't attempted to publish them in any kind of concerted way, and that's where that term plunderphonics came out of. Is that better? Is that worse? I'm particularly interested in this because I'm working on a project where I guess reading text and fixed. I'll just let that one for a bit. No, I won't.
Yeah, the smaller one has more context.
Okay, so I finally did put out a EP 12-inch record in 1988 called Plunderphonics. Everything's elongated here, like that circle at the beginning. It's supposed to be a square. I put out a CD in 1989. That whole story about talking to lawyers came out of this one. Was then commissioned, we got the commissioning thing by Elektra Records to do whatever I wanted with people from their stables, which ended up involving the Doors, which was a music a group that I had particular difficulty listening to. I never really liked listening to Jim Morrison sing. He's singing in this thing right now, and I thought maybe if I remade a piece of theirs, I might get to like it from just working with it a lot. I really like the piece I made. I still can't. There's also other groups in there. There was Faster Pussycat, Carly Simon, MC5. It seemed to have fallen into unknownness. A great Tim Buckley cut. There's a bunch of those. And then in 1992, the first Plunderphonics lecture CD came out, which had about 1,000 different artists who covered the span from 1982 to 1992, the first decade of the CD era. Commercial CDs first started coming out in 1982. The first ones were classical ones, but fairly soon after that, there was also pop ones. So pretty long piece from that era got put into this 18-minute piece, which has just been not re-released on vinyl, but as a result of the fact that I couldn't leave this piece alone and continued working on it for the past 18 years, the new lecture in a more concentrated form, and a precursor to lecture called Preplex are now available on 12-inch vinyl, just outside the store, I think. What else happened? Years. Oh, I thought you could see this. This had a lot to do with the Plunder, for the Plexure project, was making up names for pop stars that were portmanteaus of existing pop stars. Aretha Vanilli being my favorite because of the weird juxtaposition of talent and lack of talent, I guess. I like that one people on this one?
Always try them?
Yeah, who said that? Okay, this one here is a good combination of the whole pile. Any names? Any guesses? Yeah, she's in there. I think it's just the top of her head. Mm-hmm. One of the eyes is Peter. One of the eyes and the nose, in fact, the lips in this one are Peter Gabriel. And so I've done a whole pile of things with them, and I thought there was a bunch of people, but really it's just Peter Gabriel and Sinead O'Connor. Okay? So this seems pretty easy. Exactly. Is that the same guy? I can't tell. Okay, you're disqualified from the same guy. Now this one's a little bit trickier, because people think this one wrong. Somebody mentioned Annie Lennox, that's right. And what was the other one?
George Michael?
Yeah. No, sorry. That's what everybody guesses, but it's not George Michael. I always think it's funny with George Michael, because he's always struck me as somebody that was particularly beholden to the artist formerly known as Prince, right down to both having stubble at the same time. So this is Prince. The interesting thing about it was when you went back into record stores, back when I used to go to record stores, they had these sections, they had the pop section, and they had the, sometimes called the R&B section, or the soul section, or, in my time they didn't call it the race section, but they could have, the colored people section. And Prince was always in the colored people section, and George Michael was always in the white guy section, the pop section, sorry. And I always found that kind of strange, because you've got a Prince song like Strawberry Beret or something like that, and with the connection between that and R&B, and then a lot of George Michael stuff, it just obviously Prince up. Anyways, interesting racism in music. And there's an overall person here. There's nose and mouth. Just nose and mouth is somebody else who had the biggest selling pop record of the 1980s and has recently resurfaced in a particular bit of Canadiana having to do a hockey, a musical.
Olivia Newton-John.
Yeah. It's Olivia Newton-John. Let's Get Physical was the biggest selling single pop song of the 80s. Okay, that's all catchy stuff. And somebody asked about Grateful Folded. You again? Another commission, Grateful Dead, asked me to do something with their stuff, and it ended up being kind of a long project, and it's real nice. And it's just about to go into another repressing of the last four copies we have are sitting up there. There's a back cover, but if you look at back cover side too. Okay, back to our quotes, because I think we're talking about, yes, 1996 was the sort of maximum time limit for the Point of Finance box set. So then I'm supposed to talk about things I've been doing more recently, the last 15 years. Starting in the early 90s, I started off with Cronus Quartet asking me to write a piece of music for them. I started working with people who read music and doing things with classical music, which if they were appropriated things in the same way that plunderphonic things are appropriated from recorded material, if they're appropriated from existing scores by Bach and guys like that. And there's a really good example tonight, I think, at the dance concert that Johnny mentioned of the Bach stuff. I tended to call it rascally cleptoire, classical repertoire. Flipover is a one-man solo dance opera lecture by me, which is allegedly performed by me, but in fact is always, has in every case so far, been performed by Susanna Hood, who plays me in this opera. And what she's doing here is playing her own voice on a disc, a single cut disc called Belt, right, on her body that's undulating. And, you know, in this case, I didn't even get to press the button, and I'm really sorry we can't hear this, but this is quite fantastic. Where she's channeling MC Hammer right here in this choreography. And it goes from very slow to quite fast. Maybe just Just let that go in the background. You're probably tired of looking at what's been present here for now. It's a good time for other questions or comments, or somebody pointing out that we should have finished 10 minutes ago. Yes?
Whenever you explain the methods you use on valves and stabs to create the pieces on the
album? Oh, that's fine. Oh, Luke, sorry. Don't want to interrupt. Yes?
I was wondering if you like explain very detailed the methods you used on the album dab to create various cuts and whatnot.
Yeah. The question is in relation to on the Michael Jackson track called Dab, derived from Bad, from the Plunderphonic CD, the one where you saw the pretty picture of Michael Jackson as a white woman on the cover. What were the techniques involved in that? There was quite a few. I think one thing that was interesting was one of the last pieces I did completely in, well, not completely, but it was mostly an analog piece. It was using those same tape recorders, slicing tape. I was using samplers, but then the samplers are being recorded onto the analog tape. Using samplers, which is sort of a digital recording device, made it a hybrid piece, I guess. And there were quite a few particular techniques in that, which is maybe beyond us going into now without being able to hear the piece properly. But you can hear it again at this concert tonight. It'll be danced by Kate Altman. I'm particularly interested in to see what she has done with that, which I haven't seen at all. Is that okay, Bernard? Do you want something more specific about that?
Well, like, it's just that I'm doing...
I know that you just opened up your notebook and started...
I'm doing a presentation on that piece specifically, so... Yeah.
There is a paper called... There's a paper called Bad Relations, which is available on the plunderphonics.com site.
Okay.
It's a bit hard to find things in that. You'll see the word plunderphonics along the top.
Yeah,
each of those letters goes, okay, so on one of those pages, there's bad relations. And I'll try to check that too to make sure it's there. But I seem to remember it's there. And it describes all the different techniques in that piece.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Sorry. You mentioned, do you view the finished product that you have as an improvement from the pieces that you built from? Or is it just a change from the pieces that you built from?
I think, unfortunately, I see them as being improvements. Yeah, I probably should not be so qualitative and biased about it, but it's just the way I work.
Right.
Just trying to make something that I enjoy more. I think in some cases it's really an alternative. Both things are really great. I just said that thing is really great. but I really do try adding what seems to be missing in the original. In the case of Dab, is sort of interesting because what I found a bit of what I found missing in the original, which is this track Bad by Michael Jackson, was there didn't sound like there was any interaction between the musicians. There's all this great stuff going on, the song sounded great, but it seemed to be one of those really obvious examples of something that was recorded track by track in the studio. The way things are built up is somebody lays down something and somebody else will be listening to that and recording something else. And what you get is this hierarchy of kind of deafness where the people that play the first tracks don't get to hear stuff that's added on afterwards. So they don't get to respond to that sort of thing. And in the sort of way that something like jazz is all about that interplay between the musicians. There isn't that interplay. It seemed kind of obvious in that track. And so I started doing things where machines were kind of deciding where the groove was and where the beat could be, because they made it even more obvious. And I think I was trying to